Live from Lincoln Center is underwritten by General Motors and its Chevrolet, Pontiac, Oldsmobile, Buick, Cadillac, GMC truck divisions, and GMAC. General Motors, committed to excellence. Live from Lincoln Center is also made possible by grants from the Robert Wood Johnson Jr. Charitable Trust and the National Endowment for the Arts.
Good evening and welcome. I'm happy to be able to welcome you officially to the opening concert of the Chamber Music Society of Lincoln Center's 25th anniversary season. It's hard to believe that until a quarter century ago, there was no society. That meant, of course, that there was no Alice Tully Hall, which is an auditorium built to give players and audiences the feeling of intimacy that chamber music deserves. And most importantly, there was no ensemble. When you look at the extraordinary variety of programs presented season after season, you have to wonder how music lovers managed in the bad old days. And perhaps no group has benefited more from the Chamber Music Society's activities in its first 25 years than composers. The Society has been able to commission work after work and present its audiences with world premieres of music often composed for specific musicians to play. That's the case with tonight's opening piece, which is a world premiere by John Corigliano. At intermission, we'll be marking the anniversary with a portrait of the Society prepared specially for this occasion. Right now, though, it's time for music, and I'll see you later. thought I'd start off by asking you, from a musician's viewpoint, what is special or different about chamber music as opposed to performing concerti with large orchestras?
Well, I think obviously the intimacy of the musical exchange. You can have, of course, a very close relationship with the conductor, but it's limited by the size of an orchestra, even if it's a chamber orchestra. When you get into a room with one other person or three or four other people and you start working on the music, it's very special.
I can see how it would be. Because of that, is the transition difficult? If you come from just performing a concerto with a large symphony orchestra and you start rehearsing with a chamber group, do you have to do something to shift gears, or is it very different?
Well, I think that the differences are kind of obvious and generalized. I mean, you don't play with the same kind of volume in a quintet as you do at the high point of the Tchaikovsky Piano Concerto. But otherwise, it's all music making. And in a way, the kind of listening that you do with an individual clarinetist, like with David here, is the same thing that you do in the slow movement of B-flat Brahms Piano Concerto, for example. You know.
I can see how it would make a difference. The absence of a conductor means you've really got to... You guys both had to, in effect, conduct that as well as play it, didn't you?
Sort of non-conducting. It's just sort of letting the moment and the music, after we've discussed it and rehearsed it, dictate what we want to do.
Sure. Are there ever, because there's a kind of an egalitarianism there, that is there an argument any time about how the music should be interpreted?
Lots of arguments, but it's good argument. It's discussion. It's and trying to persuade by showing a reason in the score why your idea maybe should take precedence over another idea. But it's the most beautiful kind of egalitarianism.
So it usually results in a consensus then?
Yes, hopefully, anyway.
Tell us, what would you offer to us that we ought to listen for in the upcoming Schubert that you're going to be doing?
The Schubert?
Yeah.
I think the simplistic answer I can give you in this moment would be listen for the exchange of roles. Listen for when Ani has the tune and I have subsidiary, maybe I'm in third position and Gary is in the second position, and then the tune goes to Gary and Ani moves to the second position, and then the tune comes to me, and how that all interweaves, this kind of terracing and echoing and egging each other on and listening to each other. That kind of, even in the serious moments, that joyful sort of humanistic kind of prodding and poking and maneuvering.
So you, in effect, will accompany each other at different times.
Yes, exactly.
And that's different from a sonata, say, for violin, which has piano accompaniment.
It really shouldn't be different. And in a way, the thing of accompanying is, if it sounds like accompaniment in those pieces, perhaps it's not quite what
it's supposed to be, really.
Because it's just the music is supposed to flow, and your ear is supposed to be directed to the entire fabric and the main things in the subsidiary.
So even a sonata should be chamber music.
Yes, even when it is considered a collaboration. Early sonatas, for example, were written for pianoforte and violin. The Beethoven sonatas are indicated that way, rather than violin and piano.
Is that right? That's interesting. So that proves it's not...
Yeah, it should be really equal.
Well, we'll sure look forward to hearing the three of you on the Schubert, which is down the line, but we've got to make way for the Mozart now.
Yes, please listen for the same things in the Mozart, because it's a glorious piece.
Great talking with you again.
Thank you. See you later.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. let's see how it comes out. The bow for the third and fourth measures rather than the whole bow. I'd really love it if we could do that. Try it once.
Let's work out that finger again.
These five musicians are rehearsing the Mozart Clarinet Quintet. They are part of an extraordinary family who for 25 years have shared the joys of all the varieties of chamber music.
Instead of big affects, it's these, the voices arousing each other or trying to confine each other. There's a constant struggle in a piece of chamber music, which is more naked. It's not obfuscated by tonal affects as much as in a symphony or a large piece of music.
Chamber music, to me, is far more intimate than any other kind. And I find increasingly I enjoy it more and more. I feel there's that little group at the end of a room rather than here is this proscenium and this is a huge event and it's coming at me in this enormous package.
I suppose it's the most purified of feelings that one can experience. I think that especially chamber music, for me, is boiling everything down to its essentials, which is what I like to do as a dramatist.
The story of this rehearsal, of people happily caught in the grip of chamber music, is the story of the society itself. Because there is one theme underlying the past and the future of the society. The ensemble evolves and the configuration of musicians on stage is always changing. But the constant that is unchanging is a passionate and heartfelt love of chamber music. And when the world's great instrumentalists add their own distinctive voices, they do so not as soloists, but as members of the ensemble.
However, there's that funny little line. When it's time for the performance, is the ego just one step behind in importance of the music, or is the music just one step below in importance of the ego? And if the music is in second place, then you have a bit of a problem. If at that moment of performance, the ego gets sublimated for the aim of making the beautiful composition, then you have great chamber music.
There's a kind of extended dialogue going on in a work of chamber music, that the instruments are indeed speaking to one another and are interacting with each other to a degree that I don't feel in a large-scale symphonic work.
I look at a picture in one blink of the eye. I sit down and listen to a chamber music concert, and I have to wait till it progresses. Each, in the end, if they're very wonderful and moving, give you a sense of order and resolve and catharsis and peace and truth and beauty. And you leave having grown and feeling invigorated.
Okay, now we can work that out so you don't have to play any open E.
You don't like that open E.
Well, I'm not crazy about it.
I like the delicacy of the sound of chamber music, yes. It strikes a different response in me, certainly. A Mozart quartet will create an entirely different mood in me than a large-scale concerto or symphony.
This is a Mozart rehearsal, but these musicians might just as easily have been rehearsing a newly commissioned work for woodwinds, soprano, and percussion, or a Bach trio sonata, or a work with harp by Ravel. While small ensembles such as trios and quartets have long been a fixture on concert stages, it took a conscious decision and extraordinary support to fill Alice Tully Hall with such a variety of chamber music.
It's always been the aim, which is impossible to realize, to write a play that has a musical organization. I wrote Death of a Salesman on a very musical idea, which came out of chamber music a lot. It was, you see, from the first moment of that play, without any introduction whatsoever, they are in motion, the way music is. Willie Loman enters the stage. His wife wakes up from sleep, says, Willie? He says, it's all right, I came back. And we're in business. Where has he been? Why did he come back? Etc. I wanted a structure that was naked, that had no, as little as possible was of those words were to be used for non-thematic references. It would all be, its nose would be on the theme always. And in classical music, of course, that's what's happening. They don't fiddle around.
In some of the novels I've written, I was as aware of a throbbing theme going through the length and breadth of that work as I am aware of a theme going through a work of music. In Sophie's Choice, there is a constant reiterated theme of suicide. It's deliberate on my part, but I never intended for it to be, I never intended the reader to be shocked aware of this fact, but that throughout this book, at regular intervals, there is a intimation of Sophie's death by suicide. I deliberately used this theme throughout the work, hoping that it would indeed be a leitmotif, which it was, and I think in this case probably successfully, but probably also because it obeyed certain musical laws.
Well, I just wanted to say that it sounded to me too much like bum.
Yeah, it got notey, but
it's set.
No.
I think it still can have the force of bar.
Why don't you try?
The support offered to composers and the ability of the Society's musicians to bring even the boldest musical ideas to life has meant that the Society's programs have featured a long and varied list of world premieres, a history of offering new compositions to audiences.
I think musicians, well, they need an audience too. You can't just write it and put it away because it's like the tree falling in the forest. Did it fall or not?
Well, boy, I got two different signals right there. No, but I like that, you know.
Can we go from where the Dolce is, the measure 20?
Okay.
A number of years ago, one was only likely to hear chamber music well rehearsed for groups of rather traditional configuration, string quartets, piano trios. A real need was there to have a resident repertory company for all of the other works, hundreds and hundreds of works of music for diverse combinations of instruments. And what better place than at Lincoln Center? Alice Tully Hall was built to house such a repertory company, a resident ensemble.
There's a wonderful moment with each audience member, it seems, when they become totally engrossed in a moment of beauty in the work that's being played. And you hear things in the Mozart clarinet quintet that you can't think about anything else. I'll see the faces relax. I'll see a difference in the body language. And I'll know that these people have put aside everything in their lives that are troubling them and that are being moved and are being totally involved in this great music.
The chamber music work that offers the same sort of spiritual momentum or has given the same effect to me throughout my life is the clarinet quintet of Mozart. And what there is about music that creates this permanent effect is, I don't know, it's mysterious. It's almost as if it imprinted itself on the brain in a most ecstatic way, so that you're never without it in your future years. And this is simply a statement of one's ultimate reliance as a writer on this principle, which is that had I been born with all my senses alive and well, with the exception of my ears, I would never have been a writer.
The ideal play for me would be one from which you couldn't really cut a line. And that would be the case with music, where the integration of each of the instruments and the themes was such that if you disturbed it, it would come crashing down and stop.
Again.
So you don't want to do the thing?
Right, if you don't, I won't do the thing.
This is 126?
The members of the society have been and must always be a very distinct breed of soloist. They must be open to the ideas and the impulses of others, but confident enough to be unintimidated by the endless parade of guest artists, a roll call of the world's great vocal and instrumental talents who perform with them.
You spend a lot of your time being the solo pianist in the piano concerto, and then you have an opportunity to get together with two or three colleagues and talk about the piece and then have this musical conversation. You can do a lot of musical whispering, and it's a lot of, sometimes with humor, not and sometimes without humor, just a kind of knowing and endearing kind of elbow poking in the ribs and saying, you know, isn't this a nice phrase, and dovetailing things together. It's just very satisfying somehow.
Were you paying attention?
I'm always paying attention. But I'm missing a little bit of the alpine quality of this. It's a little bit more, you know, a little more beer drinking and mountain climbing. It's yodeling.
The Society is as much a part of Lincoln Center as its hall and rehearsal rooms, and both are located in the heart of New York City. The members of the Society, most of whom teach as well as being great players, are involved in bringing new audiences, all kinds of new audiences, into the fold. If these players and their loyal audiences seem to share a particular bond, it is because chamber music players and chamber music listeners are both music lovers first.
I need it in my life the way I need trees and nature in my life. You know, music is a necessity.
I can't imagine living without it. In fact, at various times, I've had to be away from any source of music, and it's after about 2 weeks, I really get hungry. to listen to something.
I could never consider being creating another line without having had this enormous and almost redemptive backlog of music sort of as part of my past experience.
Today, the society is 25 years old and more concerned with looking forward to make too much of the anniversary. And that is exactly what its founders and its earliest supporters hoped for. Today, the society is a vibrant part of its city and an irreplaceable presence on the musical landscape.